There's no reason you should be defeated. God will fight your battles with his might. So walk away from darkness, leave behind defeat. In Jesus there is happiness complete. Our God specializes in good things, things that you and I the body and spirit. All you have to do is just believe. Good things, good things. All you have to do is just
praise the Lord. God is so good and wonderful. What a glorious day it is, my friends, to worship the Lord and to learn how to walk in his word and his will. I'm Dr. Stefeni, your host, along with my co-host, Pastor Karen Weitzman, and together we welcome you to Living the Word. Did you come expecting to receive from God today? Well, if not, you won't receive anything from him. So get that expectation level elevated. You know, whatever you expect, that's what you're going to receive. So if you expect to gain wisdom, insight, and understanding and make a better revelatory connection with your heart and your mind, then hallelujah, because that's what you're going to receive. Open your hearts and your minds and prepare to receive. You know, Pastor Karen and I will be bringing you understanding of and practical application of God's word to your life. We'll be teaching you how to apply the instructions we were given over 2,000 years ago that we've had trouble applying to today. And we'll discuss the commandments, statutes, and the ordinances given to us by our blood covenant and how to operate in them in our daily life. Now, we not only will be imparting God's wisdom, but we'll also be giving you insights into our God and his character to help you grow in Christ. So I ask you now, like I said, did you come expecting to receive? Stay with us and learn how to walk successfully in living the word. Good morning, Pastor Karen.
Good morning, Pastor Stefeni. You know, we really rock to that opening music.
I know.
The audience should see us. We're sitting here just jumping and dancing to good things. Well, we both like our opening music. I don't know if the audience likes it, but we certainly do.
I do. I really do. I was thinking, because I listen to the lyrics as I'm doing, you know, rocking out. And it's really exactly what you and I were talking about. Putting away old things that don't belong to us anymore, stuff that was under the blood, and don't walk in darkness, don't walk in despair, you know, walk in the good things that God has for us. And I love it.
Yeah, I think if anybody else likes that, I mean, that would be my wake up call every morning. I would do my housework with it because it's just so upbeat.
It is.
And praising the Lord.
I can't remember when we found that song. But it was sure
a
wonderful nugget. It just blessed me and my socks off. I love it. It's just.
Yeah, you came with me with 3 or 4 songs, and I said, oh, I like that one because it's so upbeat.
Yeah.
And that's what we want the program to be for everybody. So.
Absolutely. We want them to walk away with happy hearts, not heavy hearts. Right now, my friends, take a second to assemble a small piece of bread or a cracker, a small bite of food, and a swallow of some sort of beverage or juice. It can even be water. Set them all aside. Later on, we're going to pray over them and sanctifying them as the body and the blood of Christ. But let's begin by inviting the Holy Spirit to join us. I wanted to get started today because we seemed to rush at the very end, and I just thought if we...
I really went into it.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
We could finish it.
Mm-hmm. All right, will you open us in prayer?
Yes. Family, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we enter your gates and courts with praise and thanksgiving of your holy name. You're worthy to be honored, worshipped, and adored. We lift your name on high and say how excellent is thy name in all the world. Yes. Father, we thank you today for this time to reveal to us how Jesus desires his perfected bride to be in the end times and before his return. Father, keep our church alive and not dead in works or deeds or in love for you, Jesus. You know, many Christians have pushed you, Jesus, outside of the church, and you stand and you knock and seek us and try to invite us back in. Because Revelation 3:20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me. And Father, we look forward to that time when we will be dining with you in the kingdom. And we thank you for this time that we have together today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Wonderful prayer. I love it. Now, as we prepare for God's word, we know that we need to enter his throne room. So open your hearts and minds, expecting to receive as we soak in worship.
And we'll be changed.
Father, may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be wholly acceptable to you, and may Pastor Karen's and my words be your words and your words be ours, and may they continually glorify and lift you up, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Now today we're going to continue our journey together through the book of Revelation. We go back to chapter 3 of the book of Revelation, and we pick up at Revelation 3, verse 3. It's our practice to begin by giving you the scripture from the King James Version of the Bible. Then we go into our description of what the verses mean. Remember that the book of Revelation is full of symbolism, and so we need to understand what each of those symbols mean. And in order to gain the proper understanding of the book of Revelation, that's what we're going to do. So, remember, Jesus is coming back for a church that is without spot or wrinkle. And so these admonishments from Jesus to the churches is to assist them in making changes to iron out those wrinkles. Excuse me. Revelation chapter 3. We're going to begin here with a brief recap of the first four churches so that you don't forget, or if you haven't been able to join us, and then you'll kind of get an idea of where we're going. Christ found fault with them in these churches and then added the final. We're going to go through these first four and then add the final three today in our study. We're going to pick up again in Sardis. But anyway, if Ephesus, Revelation 2, verses 1 through 7, this church had forsaken its first love. Then Smyrna in Revelation 2, verses 8 through 11, the church that would suffer persecution. Pergamum was the church that needed to repent in Revelation 2, verse 12. Then we see Thyatira, Revelation 2, 18 through 29, and this is the church that had a false prophetess. Now, in Revelation chapter 3, we continue with the last three of the seven churches. In Revelation 3, 1, it says, "And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, These things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works. Thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead." Okay. In Sardis, we see the danger of spiritual death from 1517 to 1790. We're looking at the Reformed Church. This fifth church, Sardis, is known as Sardis, the church that had fallen asleep. All right, and that's Revelation 3, 1 through 6. This church at Sardis is seen by many as the Reformation Church. Now, in this portion of our study, we're going to look at this church in the light of our modern churches. Sardis is located 35 miles south of Thyatira. One of the things that Pastor Karen and I like about this is that we see the distance between all these churches was minimal. There was like 35 miles to 65 miles or 68 miles. It wasn't really a long, long distance. Remember, they walked everywhere. So this was how they got someplace. I mean, when you think about walking 65 miles, or even 35 miles, it's a long walk. And of course, there was some that they went across the sea or across the boats across the lake or whatever, Sea of Galilee. But anyway, Sardis is located 35 miles south of Thyatira. It was the capital of Lydia and was once a portrait of strength, fertility, and wealth. And one of the things that I noticed, and just to bring this back up again for a second, that I noticed about the distance and then why I like it so much in the distance between the churches. You see the church as it started and as it grew and all the different problems that each one has is completely different than the other ones. You know, each church
has a difference. It's almost like they're starting the denominational thing there that the churches suffer from today.
Exactly.
Well, we believe this aspect of the Bible, so therefore we're going to concentrate on this aspect of the Bible. And then Jesus comes in and says, well, this is, here's the good things about what you do and here's the bad things. Because notice he didn't have the same thing to say about any of them.
That's right. I love that. That's what I picked up from it too. I thought that was just really awesome. Now, this church in Sardis, like I said, it was once a portrait of strength, fertility, and wealth, and now idolatry and immorality became its reputation. So the church at Sardis had a name, a good reputation, and it appeared to be alive. But in reality, there was nothing but inward deadness. Their deadness was at least partially due to some type of defilement, because the word says that there were only a few which had not been defiled. In Revelation 3, verse 4, these people desperately needed the ministry of the Holy Spirit. The mention of the seven spirits of God is a reference to the sevenfold ministry of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, found in Isaiah 11, verse 2. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord. And this church needed the ministry of the Holy Spirit in these areas. So if you're spiritually dead, you need these ministries also. The spirit of wisdom, a lifeless, dying church or individual needs to seek the wisdom of God. The spirit of understanding, a lifeless, dying church or individual needs a true understanding of their condition so they can correct it. Now remember that in the spirit of seven spirits of the churches, of the Holy Spirit, seven spirits of God, they're coupled together, the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of understanding. You know what I mean? They come in
a pair, in pairs.
Yeah, they come in pairs because they mm-hmm. complement one another. And where one stops, the other one picks up and goes to give you complete and total salvation, or not salvation, success. I'll just put it that way. Okay.
Okay.
So the spirit of counsel, a lifeless, dying church or individual needs to heed the counsel of God. The spirit of might, a lifeless, dying church or individual needs new strength to enter into its lifeless body. Now, the spirit of knowledge, a lifeless, dying church or individual needs to flow in renewed revelation knowledge. In other words, you need to get so steeped in the Holy Spirit that you can continually get the word of knowledge, revelation, and that you can share it. And
the words of wisdom.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The spirit of fear of the Lord is a lifeless, dying church or individual needs to have their fear of the Lord rekindled. And that is not a knee-knocking, trembling fear, so much as it is get on your face before the Lord and flatten yourself in a prostrate condition and revere the Lord. Give him reverence.
And realize that the Lord is holy.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to repent. And, you know, the church needs to repent.
That's right. So if you feel spiritually dead or your church is dying corporately and you're recognizing it, then you have to follow the fivefold plan that the Spirit gave to the church at Sardis. In Revelation 3, verse 3, be watchful. The Amplified Bible says to rouse yourself and keep awake. It's time for us to wake up, become alert to the signs of the time, and be active for God as never before. If you're not paying attention in your church, then you're not going to see whether it's dead. But if you're going through the same ritualistic motions every week and nothing is happening and you don't reach out, you don't have outreaches, you don't go do anything, you're not doers of the word, you're hearers only, you're dead, your church is dead. So you need to wake up. Now, number two, strengthen. Take a hold of the things that remain and are ready to die in your life and strengthen them through prayer and the word. Jump in the word. That's the quickest way to get an infusion. It's like getting a blood transfusion. You know, mm-hmm. you get strength from that, you get an injection, it's like a vaccination. You know, it comes against all sorts of things,
right?
And it's
you can pray the word too, so you can yeah. you can do them both at the same time. You can confess the word and also pray the word. So I agree with you, that's the best. The Bible's the best thing to get to jump into to become alert again.
That's right. And you know what, here's something that you can do to kickstart it. Start playing some hymns, some praise and worship music in your life. Put it on a CD and just dance around as you do your housework. And we were talking about that earlier.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can play something you know so that you can sing along with it. But think about the lyrics, because they'll speak to you, and then it'll get your interest going, and you can, you know, it's a good Kickstarter.
Yeah, we need to be aware that Jesus is coming back soon, and he wants us to be watchful and wants us to be I don't want to use the word zealot because that was a, but he wants to have us to have a lot of zeal and exuberance and excitement mm-hmm. for his, our bridegroom is returning.
That's right. You know, I can say this in respect to that, what you're saying. Years ago, I don't know how many, but a lot. I mean, double digits, I'm sure, at this point. I can remember just like it was yesterday, and it was amazing because I was in my living room, and I sat down on the sofa for a second, and I got this revelation. It was kind of an epiphany that it just came, and I wasn't listening to anything. It just came up in my head that the Lord was speaking to my heart through the Holy Spirit and saying that he was coming soon. And what he said to me was this, you're complacent, get out of that and start cleaning up your act, is what he said to me, clean up your act. And I started thinking about it. I thought, clean up my act. Well, I had become complacent in my, not my belief system, but what I was doing with it. Nothing, you know,
mm-hmm.
I had become, more worldly than I should have been. And so I said, okay. And he said, 'cause he's coming soon. Now to me, that was like a wake up call. So I dove into the word, and it was actually then that I remember I told everybody about this when I was reading the Bible and it didn't make any sense to me, you know, I wasn't getting anything out of it. So I got angry and said, I closed it. And I said, that's it. I don't get it. And I want you to make this come to me and be alive to me. And he did. From that point forward, mm-hmm. I mean, next time I picked up the Bible, it's been that way ever since. I read it and it's just like falling into something that's marvelous that's happening around me that I can see and I get it. Well, if I hadn't have done that, if I'd have stayed in that complacent situation, I would have been a dead, spiritually dead, I'm talking about. Who knows? I could may have not even been here. But a spiritually dead individual that was... had a form of godliness, but denied the power thereof. You know what I mean? It's like,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I heard the wake up call, and I didn't realize it at the time that it was a call for me to push me on forward to go into ministry. But it was, because if I hadn't mm-hmm. have addressed the wake up call, I wouldn't be teaching today. Instead, I would be flaccid and insipid and feeble in my Christianity. So,
well, I think we learned from Ephesus that we've lost our love. For some reason, our love has a tendency to fade. It's something yeah. about our human nature, and that's why we have the Spirit, because the Spirit arouses us to watch, to be watchful, to restore that love, that passion that we once had for the Lord Jesus Christ.
You know, and that's so true. When you speak about our love or our devotion has a tendency to fade. It does fade. You can look at that in the flesh even and see it. People don't go into marriage anymore to stay together no matter what, you know,
mm-hmm.
they go in
mm-hmm.
with, I can throw the towel in anytime I want to and dump this dude and I'm out of here, you know, and onto bigger,
right.
better things. And
there's a lack of commitment. There's a lack of commitment.
As soon as the new is off the penny and it becomes the mundane, you have to keep your marriage alive. You know, you have to work at it to put it, keep injecting happiness, wholeness and wellness into it, no matter what, because otherwise, mm-hmm. As a woman, you get tired of picking up the socks. And when you've asked him not to drop them by his chair, you know, and whatnot, and you've got a lot to do, and the men
mm-hmm.
get tired of hearing you gripe about it. You know what I mean? So,
sure.
So pretty soon we have irreconcilable, well, the word
differences
and then we head to court and dump each other and walk away. Where's the love? What happened to that couple that fell in love? And were they just in lust, you know? No, not really.
It could have been.
But for the most part, they're ready to make a commitment, but they never totally commit. Look at what they're doing in the natural. It's the same thing as what we do in the supernatural when we commit to Christ and then back away. Yeah, I love you. I know this is boring. I don't want to go here. Look at the church. Look at your life. If you're in a dead church, move to a new one. You know, try to revive it. You know, bring revival. Revival starts in your own heart, not necessarily in the house of God. You know, each individual brings revival in their heart when they come. And you're either wanting it or you're not. Okay. So remember, reflect back on the promises of God, what you have received and heard in the past times. dwell on that. What did God already do for you? You know, what have you received from the Lord over your lifetime since you've been born again? Or if you're not born again, then you need to get it. Okay. But remember to reflect back on those promises.
That's another thing. You sent me a promise Bible in a long time ago, and that has been to get me motivated or to just to confess the promises out of a promise Bible. If you have, get another Bible, get a promise Bible, and that will motivate you.
That's true. Yeah, so many, you know, I found this to be true. So many of us, including myself, I went through a period of time where I didn't really know what the promises of God were. And so I thought, well, okay. And this friend of mine gifted me with one. And it spoke to me loudly because they were right there in your face, you know, and you could go, oh, that's a promise. Oh, I didn't know that was a promise. You know, that's a promise. Mm-hmm. And it does, it stimulates you. It's really good. And I believe in promise Bibles because whoever God gave that unction to do was
That was a beautiful idea. Beautiful idea.
Okay, number four, hold fast. Hold fast to your faith, folks, and to God's word. If you don't have any faith in God's word, then you're lost. You know, you need to hold fast to your faith. Now, if you have little faith, it doesn't matter. Hang on to it and stay in God's word, and it'll start to grow. And five, repent. Repent so that you'll be ready for the return of Christ and not caught unaware. And that's what God was saying to me. Hey, get off the dime. Get back into my word. Get busy. Repent of everything that you've done and been doing that's been making you complacent and taking me for granted. And return to your first love so that when I come, and I'm coming soon, you're ready with your suitcase and your lantern lit.
You know? And oil in your lamp.
Yeah, that's right. So this church is very vivid to me because I've been in churches like this one, dead. You know, some were so caught up in their certain denomination that they were legislated instead of given themselves freely as the Holy Spirit leads. And there's a legislative organization called the National Council of Churches. And I don't normally call out things like this, but I think it needs to be said. Their purpose is to physically make the church one, not in spirit, but one gigantic denomination. However, God's plan from the very beginning has been for the churches to be one in spirit. So, my friends, you can't legislate Christianity. Now, and those under the National Council of Churches no longer taught Sunday school from the Bible, okay, but received their lessons from headquarters that were to be used, and they were tainted and wrong. Those churches had dropped many of the biblical teachings and were more into teaching social reform. What had been a way of life for many believers nearly all their lives now has changed. In many of the charismatic churches, the shouting stopped, the church became stiff and formal. Church now, more than ever before, didn't dare run overtime, not even by 15 minutes. It had to stay on schedule. Bible studies dwindled to almost nothing, and all the while, the congregation was no longer made aware of how important Bible reading and study at home was. It seems that church had taken a detour. And churches like the ones I just described is what the church at Sardis is all about. They started out just great, but as time went on, they waned away. Now, notice in Revelation 3, verse 1, that Jesus speaks of the seven spirits of God, and when the gifts of the Holy Spirit are denied and even spoken evil of, the true church will dry up. You know, I've said many times, and I know over the years that I've known you, Pastor Karen, I have said to you and reiterated times that I said that my spirit was all dried up like a cornflake before it had milk on it. You know, you put it in the bowl and you feed it the word of God, and it's like pouring milk, and you just get all soggy and wonderful. But
yeah,
I've had that feeling in my spirit, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And we remember that when we're talking about the church and these churches, we're talking about individuals because these churches represent us as individuals as well. So I understand that church is going to dry up cornflake feeling, you know. So the power of God is in his spirit, my friends. And this is why Jesus spoke to this church in that manner. The spirit's gone. This church is still flying the flag of Christianity, but denying the power thereof, okay? And I use this particular scripture in 2 Timothy quite a lot, and it perfectly describes the times that we are living in as well, and describes this church at Sardis best of all. 2 Timothy 3, verse 1. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. 2 Timothy 3, verse 5. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away.
So, yeah, and that's a very important message to our listeners today, in that if they are in a church which you don't see the Holy Spirit moving. You see everything programmed. When the Holy Spirit's there, you could go on for 2 hours with praise and worship and go on with the message and prayer and dancing and laying on of hands and healing and all that kind of thing, where the gifts of power are being used in prayer, through the laying on of hands, through healing. If you don't see that, you should question whether you are in the right church or not.
You know, I used to go to a church. My sister and I actually attended this church, and you know, the Word of God was alive. It was great. That little church was just on fire, and they had a sizable congregation. You know, we were all charismatic and jumping around like jumping beans. But anyway, the message was always excellent, and it was nobody even looked at their watch. It was amazing. Nobody even looked at their watch, but then, after you'd been there for like a couple of hours, they would go into after church, kind of after church thing, but they never released the congregation, so that we were sitting there for hours on end doing different things and going through different motions and whatnot. And they weren't ritualistic. Don't get me wrong. It was like whatever you're led to do in the Holy Spirit. And they would have people would come up for prayer and whatnot. But it wasn't orchestrated. And I said to my sister one time, can we leave? I don't know when I can leave, you know? And she said, yeah. And I said, well, I don't want to offend the Holy Spirit by walking out on him. You know, that, so my concern was that. And
may have been their policy, though, for people to just leave when they had other things to do, or that may have been their policy.
I'm sure it was. But for me, I had come from a stiff and stoic ritualistic church, and I wanted to raise my hands in it, but I couldn't, you know, because it was not done. And so when I got there, I was loving all the freedom and the liberty, you know, and that's where I actually started learning about the liberty in the spirit. But I wanted an end. I wanted it to be, okay, you can go now. Those of you that have to go, go ahead. And the rest of you, if you want to stay, we're going to be here for until the Holy Spirit says, go home, you know, into your heart. Then I would have felt, and I maintained that, I would have felt better about staying. You know, I would have felt like I wasn't walking out on the Holy Spirit. I was just leaving I had to go. And that was the only thing that I could find wrong with that little church. As it turned out, which is really kind of weird, that church split, and we all ended up going our separate ways anyway into other churches. But anyway, that's beside the point. That every church has its problems. Every church has its problems, and you're not going to find one that doesn't, because you get a whole bunch of people together with all sorts of beliefs and all sorts of misunderstandings of the Word of God. They're not united in one accord, not like the people that were in the upper room. They spent those 120 days absolutely united in the Spirit and in one accord. And when they took that 120 days to get them where they needed to be for the Holy Spirit to come and visit them, you know.
The purpose of us studying this too, because Jesus is in the midst of the church. And so he's saying, now here, I'm here. Holy Spirit is here. You're going to get what you know, you're going to get what you need, and you're going to get everything that you need to overcome.
That's right.
But just be alert to some of the problems that we've been discussing.
That's right. Well, you know, and there's a lot of denominations out there that would have us believe that the gifts of the Spirit aren't in operation today. I've heard that, and I know probably you have too. You have to understand too, folks, that Pastor Karen and I deal with a lot of different people in a lot of different denominations, and we're not denominated. So, you know, we encounter this, and we get these people because they need guidance, and not to become like
even
us,
with,
but we just need to.
Even with, going to say, even with healing, I ran into somebody and invited him to the healing room, or invited him to our church. And he says, well, I'm Roman Catholic. And I said, well, God will still heal you. Yeah. You know, it's almost like they don't think that if they don't believe in the laying on of hands or the healing power of God coursing through our bodies and us having the authority over that healing power, they don't believe they can apply, or that they can be healed.
But
they can't.
But they can be. You're right. That's absolutely true. So these denominations, like I say, would have us believe that the gifts of the Spirit aren't in operation. And if they're not, it's because of our lack of faith, folks. Remember, God never changes. We change. God is constant, unshakable, unmovable. You see, a man without a spirit is like a horse who has lost his wind. Have you ever been around a horse that's lost his wind? A church without a spirit is slowly dying, in other words. God doesn't want us to systematically go to church each week because it's expected of us. He wants us to look forward to fellowshipping with him. The love in our heart for Jesus should make us desire to go to church and even receive everything that he has for us. You know, we shouldn't be going to church for what we're going to get, except the fellowshipping and the love with the Holy Spirit, with Jesus. But what we're going to be as a body of Christ, what we're going to give to the body, to share with others.
Yeah. To share with others, maybe healing. Maybe you want a blessing that day and you need a breakthrough in your life. You know, you go to church for that very reason, to, you know, pray and to receive maybe your breakthrough and to receive the love of Jesus and fellowship with others. Mm-hmm. And that's part of the whole scenario.
I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and we were talking about a church that we'd attended together. That she and I had gone together, not gone to church together, but our families were there. We were sisters in Christ and working there in that church. And I had commented a long time ago about people congregating afterwards would come up and ask me about what the preacher had said in the service, if I understood it. And I was sharing that with her, and she said to me, I don't think they were after your wisdom of what you gathered from the service. She said, I was an observer of you in that church. And she said, and admired you and anyway, whatever. And she said, but I think that they saw love. And she said, they saw that you loved everybody and that love drew them to you like a magnet. Now, I'd never thought about that. And of course, I was flattered.
That's very
deeply
important. Yeah, the love of Jesus. Yes.
But yeah, it was like I had never thought of that for myself. You know, because I'm busy doing but always trying to keep the Christ in me, the hope of glory, alive and in the forefront. You know, but the point is, we don't realize we go to church, and what I'm talking about giving back. We don't realize that what we do and how we act and how we respond when we fellowship with others and we're loving them and showing them God's love and Christ's love in our hearts, and just in being good to them and kind and, you know, that kind of thing. We don't realize that that's Christ reaching out to them, you know? And so it's the giving back is what I'm talking about. We need to give back to one another. I thought all along it was whatever they were asking me if I got it because I did, you know, and I usually did. Mm-hmm. And I thought that all this time, and she threw another, you know, light on that. And I thought, well, you know, I'd never thought about it that way, because we don't want to flatter ourselves and take any credit or any glory. But when I was thinking about it in my quiet time past that, the Lord showed me that it was the Christ in us flowing over and overflowing. I mean, he's filled us up to overflowing with the love of his love, God's love. That's the love of Christ. And it's supposed to overflow from us and reach out and flow onto others in our circle of influence. Instead, we hesitate and go, well, wait a minute, I don't want any glory, so you know, and we shouldn't think that. It's not about us. It's about Christ. It's about loving each other.
It's about Christ, right. And I've heard a lot of people say, well, I'm the church. I don't need to congregate.
Oh, yes, you do.
Yeah. I mean, some people may never get to love their neighbor as themselves, only in church, maybe. Maybe they can't. They're older and they can't get out or whatever the situation may be. So they, fulfilling that commandment may only be done in church. And remember, the Holy Spirit didn't light upon the people in the upper room until they were in unity. They were all in one accord.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit could fill them up.
Yes, and you know,
and the light on them.
And here's the thing. You know, I've always said this is off the topic, but kind of, but not really. I always thought that it was a little, it says it tongues of fire came down upon them. And I always saw it like a little Bic lighter that went boop, and there's this flame, this little flame that went boink on, you know, and it's like, and that's not, the Lord showed me, I had a vision of this. Those tongues of fire were humongous, like a big roaring blaze, and they came and completely, they were all consuming, came down and completely encompassed those individuals, so that when they were filled, like you said, filled, they were filled from toe to top to toe, you know, and overflowing Amen. With the Holy Spirit. Amen. It was amazing. And I went, thank you, Lord, because
well,
the other was kind of ineffective.
They had to be because they were speaking languages that they didn't know.
Oh, immediately. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So that had to be filled up with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah.
Yeah. I just, but you know, I'd often thought what my mind's eye, the picture I had was ineffectual. It was like people having to reach out to do whatever to ignite that flame again and again and again, when in fact, if you're full of that fire, that's never going out. It's an what is the word? Extinguishable. Inextinguishable flame, you know? So Revelation 3:2 says, "Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God." Now, Jesus tells them here that there is still some good in this church. Build upon those things. Even the good in this church is being watered down to the point that even it is about to die. You know what I mean? I've been in churches that are, they water the word down, and they're just so social organizations is what they are. Having an ice cream social, you know, and everybody goes for the potluck and, you know. But the word
well,
is flaccid.
I even talked last time about even their outreach ministries, you know, have been watered down to the point where you can't go and talk about Jesus with these people. You know, you can go and help them out and what's your religion and that kind of thing. But if they don't want to talk about Jesus, you're not supposed to talk about Jesus with them. Family, we're not witnessing if we don't talk about
Jesus with them,
you know.
And our,
so even their outreach programs and their ministries have been watered down too.
Well, and you know what, you're right, because I used to go to like picnics, there were picnics, and I've been in some churches where the you're charismatic, you're full of fire, you're full of the Lord, and you're just, you know, praise the Lord, hallelujah, you know. And you can't do that because it's like they look at you like you have four heads. You know, it's like, wait a minute, King's X, get away from me, you know. And that's a really, and they're in a charismatic church. But that's what I mean. We don't raise our hands anymore. We don't have free and total abandon when we worship the Lord. You know, David danced before the Lord in his underwear, for pity's sake. You know, not that I'm saying strip down.
Yeah,
you know?
Who was it? Didn't his wife get upset because he was dancing in front of the Lord all the time?
Yeah, her name is Michael. Yeah, she was just irate and incensed. She said that he was, it was shameful, you know, that he would act like that. Now, Jesus tells them here that there is still some good in this church. Build upon those things. And the works here spoken of are saying they're not doing works, but that their works are slanted more toward the world than toward God. So if you have a mega
church.
That's
what I was saying.
Yeah.
That's what I was saying. They're making rules according to the people rather than according to God.
Yes. And you have to, you pastors out there that have mega churches, those churches get bigger than you are. And really fast. So you have to have a good, solid administrative body in place that will keep an eye on that, because it's real easy to slide down that slippery slope into social activities and all this wonderful do-do-do-do-do that isn't doing anything, you know?
Right, so, and I visit a woman who's in assisted living, and she was from Nebraska and now is in Colorado. And she's, of course, everybody gets upset when they're uprooted from their home.
Yeah.
And she has a soprano voice that is like excellent. We sang Christmas carols together, but she wants to go to church. She misses Christ. She misses the Lord. And, you know, we sit and talk about the Lord and so forth, but I guess the assisted living does not have the van or wherever they take them. They don't have the van to take them into church. And so this is an area where they're worried about lawsuits and what is it called? Injury of the person,
liability, you know,
more than they are about the person receiving God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I spoke up not to the, but I spoke up to the church that sent me and said, you know, these people want to go to church. We have to find a means for them to get to, you know, for them to sing and do what they love to do and be in the church.
You know, if they can't make it there, then the church can go to them.
Yes, most of these places have the church going to them, but here is a woman that excelled in her music.
Oh, and she wanted to be part of the choir.
Supreme soprano, and she wants to be part of the choir.
Oh, yeah. Somebody should just be volunteer to go get her and bring her, you know?
Yeah.
I know what you mean, though. Everybody's insurance minded.
That's the next thing, but no, I can't interfere. That's another thing. You can't interfere. You just go and visit.
That's right.
And I did tell the director that I would come and pick her up and take her to church.
Yeah.
So we'll see. We'll see what happens. But that those are some of the things that you're dealing with, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's there, you know,
the world.
If you took account of how many true conversions were made within the last year in a church that's dead, so to speak, like this Sardis church, you would be amazed at the shortage. What we call good works and what God calls good works are two entirely different things. God looks at the spirit, and we have a tendency to look at the physical, you know. Now, Revelation 3, verse 3 is where we left off. That's where we're going to pick back up now. This was all kind of a recap. That's the way, you know, that's why I started early.
I think we said some new things.
I think so, too. Remember, therefore, how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. All right, here, Jesus is saying your message at the beginning was okie dokie. Go back to that, the pure word of God. All right, and some new Bible translations are watering Jesus down to the point that he's not God. He's not God, you know, in them at all. Some Bible colleges would have their people believe that Jesus was not born of a virgin, and that the Red Sea didn't part, that Jonah wasn't truly swallowed by a large fish, and many more biblical evidences that they have indicated are really just fantasy. I don't know about you, but I believe the word of God, and if God said it, that settles it. That's what happened.
I know. And the Red Sea has so much implications. I mean, if you've really studied the word, you know how important. Some people think that that's the rapture in the book of Revelation, the Red Sea opening, and they point to that. And you know what I'm saying is Jesus being born of a virgin, and how important that is for the you know, you just can't come against it.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the Red Sea, I read an article one time where this fellow was I don't know what to call him, but he was they'd go out and they'd check out the biblical things like the ark and where it was. And they'd go up to the ark, the Noah's ark, and where they found it in Mount Ararat. And they would look
at historian or an archaeologist,
kind of like everything, you know, like that. He was actually a dentist, but his profession was dentistry, but he did this in his own, and his family went with him, and they were seeking, they weren't trying to prove him wrong, the Bible wrong. They were trying to bring these artifacts to life and see if they actually measured up to what was in the Bible, if they were just phony or if they were real. Well, anyway, he did a study on the Red Sea. Parting of the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there is a Red Sea, and there's also a swamp called the Red Reed. And they insisted, the people that live there, and their historians over there where the Red Sea is, insisted that that did not part the Red Sea, that these people, that Red Reed place, it's Red Reed Sea, is a place where they've done a lot of battles, and they found some artifacts there, chariot wheels and stuff like that. So that's what made them decide that it wasn't the really Red Sea that had done it. But if you read the scripture and you read about it, all the scriptures, you see that Pharaoh and his army and all of them were covered completely in the water. So this stuff is only up to your, like, right in mid shin, you know, and they could not have been swallowed by that water. You know what I mean? And, anyway, but because they found some artifacts there, they thought that that was the Red Sea, and that this Red Sea parting and all the stuff walking across on dry land and all this did not happen. at the Red Sea. It happened there.
Oh, my God.
And so he went there to prove it different, you know. And as it was, he didn't get the proof he wanted, but he didn't agree with him still. He said, you know, he was going to stick with the Bible and what it said. But he could see where the artifacts that they found would indicate that. But that happened to be, where that Red Sea was, happened to be a battlefield over the centuries, eons and eons and thousands of years, where people would go and do battle there, you know.
I see.
And, so naturally, they're going to find stuff like swords and, you know, all kinds of things. Well, anyway, so what they're doing is they're reducing the miraculous workings of God and trying to analyze them with what they're calling scientific knowledge. You know, that's my reason for calling that up. This is just another attack of Satan trying to destroy the beauty of Christianity, folks. These are basics to the belief of our salvation through Jesus Christ. And if a mere man died for your sins, you're lost. I'll just tell you that right now. Jesus was God manifest in the flesh. He was the perfect Lamb of God. He was and is life. To deny that he was born of a virgin denies that he's God the Son. And I actually attended a church that, you knew I'd bring this up. I attended a church that the pastor believed that. And I was in a new members class, and he was talking about the denomination and giving freedom to believe what you want. So I asked the question, what did he mean by that? And he went on to explain that they were real laid back. Some people, I said, what do you mean by that? And he says, well, some people don't believe that in the virgin birth. And I went into orbit. I said, well, what do you believe? He's confessed that he held that belief. To shorten the stories, suffice it to say, I left the class and that church.
Sure.
But you see, Jesus's father must be God. Has to be. These false teachers say the Red Sea didn't part, like I was just saying, it was only ankle deep. You know, and that's not the case at all. There is a conspiracy going on to deny the deity of Christ, and it's orchestrated by the enemy. This is an extremely dangerous road to travel. You know, if we deny Jesus, he'll deny us before the Father. Matthew 10, verse 30.
And I'm sure that these same people do not believe in a rapture.
No, of course not. That's really outer
these
space.
These same people, these same people will not believe in the rapture.
Yeah.
Well, they're always, you know, people are always trying to take something that's spiritual and making it mundane. You know,
yes.
I've even heard some people say, well, Jesus had to be married.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
No.
I know what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Horrible.
You know,
now these false teachings include a teaching that there's no heaven and no hell, that they are just a state of mind, and that people say, well, we're in hell here now on this earth. Well, I have to agree that we are in a portion of it, but only to the what it's not what we're talking about at all. So the Bible speaks explicitly about both and even tells us that what they'll be like. You know, all of this is significantly preposterous, all these false teachings. And we have to believe the Bible in its entirety or not believe it at all. You can't believe part. You've got to take it all and digest it. You may not like what it says, but believe it, because if God said it, that settles it.
Amen. Now,
I would never tell you what to believe, or I would tell you what's right about the Bible, but I certainly won't tell you what I believe. But in this case, as for me, I believe the Bible in its entirety. And Jesus was Emmanuel, God with us. To deny Jesus as the Christ, the Son of the living God, is to deny salvation through him. So you might as well get that in your head and think about it.
Sure.
Okay, Revelation 3, verse 4. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Okay, Jesus is saying here that there are a few people, even in this church of Sardis, or our fallen away church now, that are still strong in the Lord. They believe the truth rather than the lie. A defiled garment is one not washed in the blood of the Lamb. And you see, the white, as we must wear, is a white robe made whiter than snow by being washed in the blood of the Lamb. So this is our robe of righteousness that we'll wear in heaven. Righteousness means in right standing with God. Most churches now that are like this church in Sardis don't like to preach or teach on the blood of the Lamb or blood of Jesus. You mentioned Jesus. They won't sing power in the blood. You know, they don't want to talk about the blood.
Mm-hmm.
It was the shed blood that defeated Satan and purchased our salvation. We read in Hebrews just about how important this shed blood is. Hebrews 9, verse 22 says, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. There it is in black and white, you know. If we're not washed in the blood of the Lamb, then we're walking in sin. Period, end of report. So we're going to study later in a later lesson in chapter 7 of Revelation about the great number from all nations standing around the throne in their white robes. Okay, Revelation 7, verse 14, and I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. So to deny the power of the blood would deny us our right to stand before the throne of God. Do not be deceived. Believe the word of God, the Bible. Let no one convince you that it's not true. Any comments?
No, I had just made a list of what a Sardis church might look like today, and we had talked about some of those points. Their baptism is like sprinkling them with water and not dunking them and immersing them in Christ, mm-hmm. going under the water and coming back out again, being born in the Spirit. We talked about them having a form of godliness, but denying the power, not using the gifts of the Holy Spirit in the church. You can tell that the Holy Spirit is absent, even maybe when they give a testimony. There's no exuberance or excitement of what the Lord is doing in their life. They're just relating maybe some facts. We talked about the church not studying from the Bible. They're more stiff and formal, maybe legislating Christianity a little bit. And we talked about them, a dead church would be one that would just maybe talk about how good the sermon was or how good the choir sounded today, but they're not relating to Jesus. They're not talking about who they prayed for. They're not talking about who they laid hands on, how they got their blessing, their altar call, how they were immersed in the Holy Spirit at the altar. And then we talked about a little bit about the works. No inward fire for Christ. They're listening to the world's principles and rules when they go to witness to somebody rather than being on fire for God and giving a fiery testimony mm-hmm. of what God has done in their life. So those are just a few of the things that I had written down of what a Sardis church might look like. You might have some more to add there, Stefeni. I don't know.
No, we pretty much covered it. I think you did a really good job there. Revelation 3, verse 5, He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. This is a vitally important thing. Before we go on, I want you to understand something here. It says here that I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. We know that the Lamb's Book of Life, the Lamb's book, is our salvation book. There, we have to understand, this is not the Book of Life. The Book of Life is what he's talking about. Every creation that was ever created by God, human being, was recorded mm-hmm. in the Book of Life. And that was like a census, so to speak. Okay? Mm-hmm. Their name is mm-hmm. in the Book of Life. Once you're born again, your name is then written in the book of the Lamb. Okay? That is the salvation book. Then you are regaining your citizenship in heaven. This is the creation book. This is your salvation book. Okay? So the Lamb's Book of Life is the book. It's not this book of life. But the Lamb's Book of Life.
It's not what this book of life
is. Okay. All right. So you can say, well, here's this book, and your name is written in there. But if you want to look at it this way, but when you get born again, now it's bold. The print is bold. So he looks at all the bold print, and those are the people that are citizens of heaven. You can look at it that way instead of like two books, but that is not the Lamb's book. Anyway, so that you know, if your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life, you are in heaven. You are a citizen of heaven again. And now you will go to heaven and you will be with Christ, and you are forgiven all your sins, past, present, and future. And so you will never be judged again, ever. If your name is in this...
And you'll be clothed in white raiment.
That's right.
What we're talking about
That's
here.
Right.
You'll be clothed in white raiment. Okay.
But those whose names are not bolded or not over in the Lamb's Book of Life, I'll put it that way, mm-hmm. those will show up at the great white throne judgment. And those are not born again. And you can be calling yourself a Christian. This is my point. You can be saying, because you go to church every Sunday, but you know who Jesus is and you know who God is, but you don't have a relationship with either one of them, you may end up at that great white throne judgment. So you may want to think about this a little bit. If you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, you have a relationship with Him. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. You are now over in the Lamb's Book of Life, guaranteed never to be judged again. And you don't go to the great white throne judgment. You go to the Bema Seat of Christ for rewards. Okay? So just a little nugget there.
That's a good nugget that, you know, you should repeat quite often, because I don't think people really understand that. And I didn't really understand that there were two books.
Well, it is. Now, there's people that say that's not the same thing. This book of life is the Lamb's Book of Life. And if that's the case, that's why I said then the print is bolded so that he can see who's saved and who isn't. We don't all just coexist in this book. But the book of life is the book of creation. And they could call it the book of creation of every individual that was ever. And I'm talking about babies who were aborted. Every life has been recorded there. Now, those who accept Christ, I don't know what happens with the aborted. I know that all children go to heaven before the age of accountability. So they would automatically be transferred over or bolded out. But if you don't believe in the two books, that's fine. Don't have to. All right. You can believe in one book. Just know that when the print is bold so that they know who is who. Otherwise, that wouldn't make any sense. What these scriptures would not make sense, but there, because we would all be collectively in one bucket, and that isn't the way it is, you know. Too, God is a God of order, and the books, the volumes on Jesus's life, he was only in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights, where he encountered every single trial and tribulation that we have ever had in our lives or will have, every disease, everything. That came, and he went through it without any sin, without succumbing. But we only have three incidences recorded in the Bible. But there's volumes of all his works. We only have a few times that he went through and healed people. You know, I mean, when you really get right down to it. But there's volumes in the library in heaven of all of his works, all of his miraculous doings. So you
know
that that's why you have to look at this. God doesn't have one little tiny ledger book. You know what I mean? He has his own system set up. But I was concerned about this and a long time ago, and I was before the Lord, and this is what he told me. That book is the book of all creation. This book is the Lamb's Book of Life. And when you give your life to Jesus Christ and you are born again, your name is then written in that book. And you are
his
child. You become a child of God. So there isn't any confusion. And remember, God is a God of order. Now, we are clothed. If you're born again, you are clothed in white raiment. And that's what he's saying here. He that overcometh, he that is born again, that is an overcomer, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. If these people are some decent people that are still godly, they're still wanting to do the right thing, still living the right way in this church in Sardis, you know, these people are
Their works are starting to die.
Yeah.
That they can reinvigorate themselves
exactly.
again.
And those people he'll save, in other words. You know, they're candidates for salvation, and they will be clothed in white raiment. If they overcame, it's because they gave their life to Christ. And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. So this is one of the greatest promises in the Bible. We have to overcome the world and its teachings to inherit eternal life. How do we do it? We overcome it by getting born again. And, our name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life, which will ensure us of our eternal life in heaven with Jesus. And of course, we know that we don't live in heaven forever because we come back here. But we want to go there. You know, if God tarries, I want to go there. Now, if we confess Jesus before men, he will confess us before the Father, and we stand or fall by his command. You can see from the statement that I just shared with you that overcoming is not a bed of roses. It's difficult. We get trials and tribulations because it creates perseverance. If we stand and endure and do what the Bible says, do what God says, then we'll overcome.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons I like the book of Revelation and its talk about churches. Otherwise, we would just go to church and sing songs and come home and lead our lives and not realize that there's an overcoming process here.
Well, yes, and we would end up being feckless, you know, absolutely feeble in our Christianity. Now, remember that this is a battle. We go through the battle, but Jesus already won the war. So knowing that he won gives us the opportunity to automatically become overcomers. If you know what the Word of God says, then Jesus won the war. So these battles are for us to like reenact. It's like a reenactment. So we reenact them, but we already know we won. So it makes it easy for us. Why? Mm-hmm. How do we do it? We apply what God's Word says to apply to our lives, and we are automatically overcomers. You know, we have to enlist in the army of Jesus, and we have to fight to the death if necessary for the principles that he has taught us in his word. We stand fast and hold on to our faith about what the word says. That's what our job is, the Bible. Now be strong. Amen. Don't be led away by all these new teachings of heaven on earth before Jesus comes, because that's a bunch of hogwash. The only time the earth will be like heaven is during the 1,000-year reign of Jesus right here. And we have to be raptured out of here before that happens. The church has to be. So withstand the devil,
Amen.
And he'll flee from you. Be part of the elect who can't be deceived. Okay. Revelation 3, verse 6, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Again, we are told to hear what the Spirit said to the churches. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Incline your ear. Revelation 3, verse 7 starts us with the Church of Philadelphia. And I'm looking at our time. Do you think we have time to go into it, or... shall we go forward?
Yeah, I think we have.
Okay. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. Okay. Now, we cast our view upon Philadelphia. The church at Philadelphia was known for these issues by Christ. Philadelphia, the church that had endured patiently. That's Revelation 3, verse 7. So here we find the danger of failing to advance. The Church of Philadelphia was from 1790 to 1900 AD, and it's known as the Missionary Church. The city of Philadelphia was 25 miles southeast of Sardis, an 800-foot rise it was positioned on. And to this church, which Christ says has little strength, the Lord comes to open an avenue of opportunity that no force in hell can shut. The expression Jesus uses, possessing the key of David, means that he has the authority to open this supernatural door. The reference to those who say they are Jews and are not refers to all who reject Jesus Christ. Now, Romans 2, verses 28 and 29 explains what constitutes a Jew.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I'm sorry. Before you go on, you know, we have to remember that the first Christians in these churches were Jews.
That's right.
They were Jews. So the outside Jews would be persecuting them, but also there might be some chaos within the church also. Mm-hmm.
You might be able to explain this because of your understanding of the Old Testament and the Jewish faith, that Judaism, you might be able to do a better job on this particular Romans 2 verses 28 and 29 than I am. But
okay, well, let's see what it says.
All right. It explains what constitutes a Jew. For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God.
Yeah, this is what happened to the Jewish believer, is that, you know, they were talking about, they were wanting the Gentiles to be circumcised outwardly. But Christ is looking at the heart all the time. So as God tells us in one Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, I don't know which one it is, but he says the Jews will accept Jesus through jealousy of the Gentiles. Yeah. Because you see, the Gentiles will receive the Holy Spirit. They will receive that circumcision of the heart with the commandments written on their heart. And the Jews will be jealous of that. And so that's how they will come, even though their hearts weren't right. The Jews' hearts were not right. Mm-hmm. And so the Gentiles were. And so they're going to become jealous of the Gentiles, and that's how they will come to believe in Christ. Otherwise, Jesus says they're following Satan. That's what he says right here. We're going to come to that. But that's what he says that they're that's why he calls the church a church of Satan, because of the Jews not receiving him as God in the flesh. They had difficulty receiving him as God in the flesh.
Yeah, Jesus shows himself to this church of Philadelphia in the very same way that they worship him. Number one, he's holy. Jesus tells us to be holy, even as he's holy. Our evidence is Leviticus 11:44 and 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15. Number two, he shows himself as the truth. He is the way, the truth, and the life, John 14, verse 6. Jesus is the one that opens the door to heaven or hell for us. That's what it means by open us and shut us. But anyway, Jesus is the door to heaven.
He opens it that no one can shut, and he shuts what no one can open.
That's right. He's the only one who can open or shut either door. He took the keys of hell away from the devil when Jesus went there and preached. And Jesus is the final judge of everyone's resting place. This church in Philadelphia is its symbolic church today. And they're not only aware of who Jesus is, but they are patterning their lives after his. They are the very elect, full of the word, so full that it would be terribly difficult to deceive them. So God promises these believers that he will keep them from the hour of temptation, which will come upon all the world. And note that the event spoken of is a definite time period, the hour, and it's a period of trial. And it was future from the time of John's writing. So it was to be worldwide. The promise in Greek was to keep thee out of the hour. So these facts make it evident that the event refers to the Great Tribulation, which is described in Matthew 24, verses 15 through 22. And we see that these believers at Philadelphia, who have only a little strength, yet have nevertheless kept God's word and have not denied his name, God promises that they will become pillars in the temple of God, Revelation 3, verse 12.
Does this mean that only the Church of Philadelphia will be raptured?
No.
Before the Great Tribulation?
No, it's not that. Okay. Remember, it's not that he's saying that. He's saying that they're overcomers, these Philadelphians, because they had little strength, but they nevertheless kept that word of God and never denied God's name and Christ's name, that they'll become pillars in the temple of God. So, you know, in heaven, when they're building the church, and we'll get into that later on in Revelation, there are pillars that are set in the church. These few are stalwart. They are a memorial in God's eyes. He'll set a memorial and bring them in as pillars, our foundation of the church, the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. They're a foundation for them. And that's what that means.
Okay.
So this church may have been small in number or in material resources, but God was going to make them strong. You know, here's the thing. We have churches all over the place now. In your home. I mean, I have one in my home. And that kind of thing. So that we don't have and we have mega churches and we have regular churches that have been around forever. But the body of Christ is sprinkled throughout these churches and these denominations. So what he's talking about here is you take this little bitty church, maybe a home church similar to mine, and if the people that come to that church are strong in the Lord and they believe and they stand for him and they never waver, you know, those people, no matter if it's a church with five people in it, stand for this and represent this pillars of the temple in heaven. Okay.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So they are promised an open door. In other words, and in scripture, an open door refers to Christ, John 10, verse 7, an opening to preach the gospel, Acts 5, verses 19 through 20, and the rapture of the church, Revelation 4 through 7. These people represent the body of Christ that stands firm. There's a word I want, but I can't get it. Anyway, unmoving,
stalwart.
Exactly. They don't move. They're immovable. You could run over them with a tank and they'd still stand up. You know, it's like, even though you run me down, I'll stand back up because I'm never going to lay down. I'm always going to stand for Christ. And these are the ones that he's talking about regarding the rapture of the church. Each of these may be interpreted as the open door promised to this church, even as each can be applied to the church today. Why? Because Christ is in spirit now here, and his only way he can get through to everybody is to come through people like that. You see? So mm-hmm. It's not the guy who's standing.
Otherwise, he's saying He's standing there waiting for you to knock on the door. But with these people, the door is already
blown open. it's blew off its hinges, yes. You know, type thing. Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And his word is coming through them. This is what he's talking about. This is where you see him. You see Christ the way that he wants you to see him in these individuals. Yes, they're in the world. Yes, they're struggling. And yes, they're standing. They're even though their strength is weak, you know, they may not be really mm-hmm. strong. They're not big in number in one area, but they're strong and they're reaching out and you can see them. You can see him. Oh, down on 4th and Vine is this guy who stands there and he does nothing but talk about the power of God and in your life. But he never moves. He's there faithfully every day and his word never changes and it's always strong. And if you don't understand it, he'll take time to explain it to you. You know, these are what we're talking about, these kinds of people. And in these end times, God's opening many tremendous doors of opportunity. And there's always an inherent danger of failing to advance at Christ's command. Now, you may feel you've only a little strength, but you know what? God can make you a strong and mighty pillar in his kingdom. All right. So that's what he's talking about. And these pillars, they're symbols, okay? And so we'll get into the symbols later, what they are. But anyway, a spiritual warrior who's able to walk through every door.
They're like foundation.
Yes, exactly. And these are spiritual warriors who are able to walk through every door that Christ opens because it's his spirit that opens the door. So let me ask you, what's holding you back from fulfilling God's call in your life? Is it fear? Maybe your finances or the lack of them? How about your health, your relationships with others? God has set before you an open door which no man can shut. All the demons in hell can't shut it. They can't do anything to it. Jesus is the way. All you have to do is walk through those doors in the almighty power of God. Don't let stuff in the world hold you back. Revelation 3 verse 8. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength and hast kept my word and hast not denied my name. Do you fit that bill? Think about it. Jesus is aware of everything the churches are doing. He has firsthand knowledge because he walks in the church. Jesus is the door and has provided himself for us to go through into heaven. Now, I have to say this because people think to, and they'll say to me, well, how do you know? Just what makes you an authority? How do you know that what you're saying is the truth? Mm-hmm. I'll tell you why. Because there isn't any office that you stand in that says interpreter. But God has blessed many of us, millions of us, with gifts of interpretation. And I happen to have that gift. And when mm-hmm. I asked him to make the Bible come alive to me, he blessed me with that gift. Because my heart's desire was to understand. And I'm not saying that I'm the only one or that makes me special. No, no, no. It just, what's in your heart? Look at your heart. What do you want? What do you want from God? Personally, I wanted to crawl up in his lap and have him, you know, talk to me. I wanted to know what makes him tick. I wanted his wisdom and still do want his wisdom. I want to know everything there is to know about him. All that he'll let me know, let's put it that way. I know that I'm limited, but you know what? If I came out of him, I was his essence and created from his essence in my spirit, then there's something that's drawing me to him. So I want to know what that is. I want to know all about him. It's an obsession. I can't stop.
You know, we can ask God to show us the open door. He showed me the open door when I began laying hands on people. Mm. He showed me the kingdom resounded back to me.
That's right.
And the supernatural came into the natural. So you can ask God to show you, you know, to keep, you know, keep that door open and to show you heaven's impounding or impeding on earth.
That's right. You know, Jesus is the door and has provided himself for us to go through into heaven. And the door that Jesus opens can only be closed by him. And Jesus cares for his own folks. It's very interesting here that he says this church has a little strength. And this is very true of all strong believers. In our weakness, Jesus is strong. We're all weak in some area. In many areas, But where we're weak, he is strong. And that strength sustains us. And he sees us through, and it's his strength, not our own. Mm-hmm. So the very good statement Jesus makes about this church is that they have kept his word. We too have to be cautious to guard the word of God. The Bible is our instruction book for living. That's all in the world it is. And if we change it in any way, the instructions won't work. You cannot change the recipe. It'll ruin it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But many have watered down the word until it has been short-circuited and lost power. We see it all the time. Look at what this world has become. We must not tamper with the power. This church mentioned here might be small in size, but big in love and huge in the Holy Spirit. Now, again, we see so many denying the name of Jesus. Here, the name they're denying is that Jesus was God. And this is what you were talking about, Pastor Karen. We touched on it before. It's worth mentioning again. Most churches today want to call Jesus a prophet, a teacher, a healer, man. Very few realize that he was God manifest in the flesh, God the Son. And this is a very important thing, and it will be mentioned more and more as we go. Okay, Revelation 3, verse 9, behold, I will make them the synagogue of Satan. And this is where you were going. Do you have that scripture in front of you? You want to go with it?
Behold, I will make them the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews, and they are not, but they do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. And so that's what I was talking about. When they see how much God loves the people, the Gentiles and so forth, the Gentile believers, then they will be provoked into jealousy and into the belief of God being the Lord Jesus Christ.
That's right. Actually, there's no difference, really. I mean, in someone who follows Satan and somebody who pretends to be a Christian and is not. But the Christian that's pretending to be a Christian and is not probably doesn't realize it. They need to wake up.
Yeah, he doesn't realize. They don't realize it.
Yeah, both are lost. The synagogue of Satan is a place of worship where God isn't Lord. Simple. A Jewish mm-hmm. synagogue could be of Satan if evil prevailed. A church, it could be any church building where we go and meet and gather to worship God. If God is
present.
Well,
Satan does come to church.
Big time.
Satan comes to church and he doesn't mind if you go to church. What he minds is when you start coming after him, casting out demons and using the power gifts mm-hmm. of God. That's what he minds.
That's right. So a body of Christians meeting could also be a synagogue of Satan if the true word of God isn't taught and received. And that's basically what you're saying. So there's going to come a time when the truth will prevail. And the church, which doesn't compromise and prevails unto the end, shall reign with Christ. Jesus is just encouraging this church that has tried so hard that there will be a day of reward. And that's what he's saying. Hang in there, guys. You know, the Christians will rule over those who have rejected Jesus for thousands of years here on this earth, as we will see later on in Revelation. Jesus loves the faithful. He has his ear turned to our needs. Okay, we're going to try to go forward. Revelation 3, verse 10. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Trials and tribulations and temptations come to everybody. It seems the group here mentioned have been tested and found to stand in their temptation. There's a time of testing and a time of victory or defeat. Jesus was tempted 40 days and 40 nights and came out victorious. And when trials come, we can do one of two things. We can either stand against the temptation and experience victory, or we can take the easy way out and succumb to temptation and fall to defeat. If you're a Christian and the temptation wins, then you'll go through that particular temptation over and over and over, go around the mountain 40 years, basically like everybody did, until you stand against it and overcome it. You have got to come against it and stand. Why? Because the proof's in the pudding. You know, that's what we're here for. It appears that this group mentioned here has stood against these temptations, so their promise from Jesus is that they won't be required to go through the great temptation. Okay, there's a time specified of God when the temptations, tribulations, and trials will be so great that it'll be next to impossible to stand. An hour with God can be any specific time. God's time and our time is not the same. This hour mentioned here certainly doesn't mean 60 minutes, but a period of time that God stipulates. The tribulation, there will be 7 years of tribulation at the end of the Gentile age. And that's what we're in right now, is the Gentile age. The last 3.5 years of this will actually be the wrath of God. God has promised the believers in the Lord Jesus Christ that we will be saved from the wrath to come. Now, this appears to be the case here. Temptation here is the same as tribulation. Revelation 7 verse 9 and 7 verses 13 through 14 tells of the Christians who are saved from the unbearable temptation at the end of the 3.5 years of tribulation, which is the great tribulation that's forthcoming. Revelation 7 verse 9 says, "After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands." Revelation 7 verse 13 says, "And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, What are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they?" Revelation 7:14 goes on, "And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." You see, these are the believers in Jesus the Christ, the saved, who have been brought saved in the great tribulation. Matthew 24, verses 21 and 22 describes the severity of this great tribulation. "For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor shall ever be. And except those days should be shortened, there should be no flesh saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened." This is the hour of temptation. This scripture in Revelation 3 verse 10 is speaking of. The believers in Jesus will be taken out just before this begins. That's the rapture.
I've had some people say that just before the wrath of the bowl, the bowls of wrath, they believe that there will be a rapture.
Mm-hmm. Well, we have no idea when that time is, because it's only God's timing. And as a day with the Lord is as a thousand day. What is it? A day. I used to know this. A day
with the Lord
is as a thousand years. Yeah. And a thousand years is as
like
a day.
A thousand years is like a day.
Yeah. So if we wanted to equate that, we could be tarried here a long time, you know. So what are we going to do with our 120 years, you know? Revelation 3:11. "Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast with that which thou hast, that no man take thy crown." This statement in verse 11 is just verifying that we have already, what we've already said, and that's, there's a test time for the believers. We've been tested, we're being tested, and we have to go through those tests and those trials, and it's how we respond that we're judged. Okay, we'll be required to stand, and when we do, then we will be raptured and saved from the terrible horrors that come. Revelation 3:12, "Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name." Okay, that's confusing. Now, again, we see here that there is something that we must overcome. A person, many times, is spoken of as a pillar of the community or a pillar of the church, which just means that they're strong and that they're holding up the church, that they are great tithers and givers and doers in the church and that kind of thing. And these people would be like founding fathers, high in principles. They would be the ones who would see to it that the church stays on solid ground by advising the pastor and keeping him on track.
If we're talking about Philadelphia, they would always also be the ones that would be strong in the word.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So this writing of the name of God just means that we are sealed into his kingdom. If we were to read very much about this city, we would find that sometimes it's spoken of as a bride. The believers in Jesus are the bride of Christ. And this name of the city being on the believers just indicates that we are the bride of Christ. This new name of Jesus that's written upon us is showing that we're Jesus's possession. We are his. We have been bought and paid for with his blood. When it says we shall no more go out, it means that our eternal home is here with Jesus. Verse 12 says that we are the believers. We have put our trust and faith in Jesus and endured hardship. We then have an eternity of nothing but pure joy in this new Jerusalem with Jesus. And once we have passed from death into life through accepting Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are sealed by Jesus himself. We belong to him. No one can snatch us back away from him. Jesus has the keys. Look to him and no other. He is salvation. Now he that hath an ear, Revelation 3:13, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Once again, we're told to hear what the Spirit said to the churches by Jesus himself, who spoke these words, as all these messages to these churches are printed in red. Now, it reminds us, once again here, to open the ears of our understanding to his teachings and remember that mankind is the one who put the red on the words that Jesus spoke for ease of recognition, so you'll know when he's speaking easily. Revelation 3, verse 14, and unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans. Aha! Do we have time to start this one?
It's 2:33.
Ew. I think we better wrap, and we'll pick this up next time, because we're going to be hanging out here in Laodicea quite a while.
Yeah, we need to talk about lukewarmness of the Laodiceans.
Oh, boy.
Probably.
Yeah, we've got a lot of heavy stuff here. I always looked at the church. Well, I'm not even going to go there. You know why? Because if I do, it's going to ruin what I was going to talk about we'll talk about it when the time comes. But you know what? If I get back here, we're in my outline because I had to go past it.
I was just thinking of the difference between, and we might talk about this next time. I'm hearing my voice coming back at me.
Oh, you are? Maybe it's my volume. Let me turn it down on my speaker, because that usually is what. Now try it. Is that better?
But the two good churches, I still hear it, but that's okay. The two good churches were Smyrna and Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. Both received persecution, right?
Yeah.
Or Jesus is saying he's trying to keep the Philadelphians from receiving any persecution.
Philadelphia, is known, our Philadelphia is known as the city of brotherly love.
Right.
Which carries over from the Bible, because it is. It's when they loved each other. They were, but they were, that was another church, and really of the two, Smyrna and Philadelphia. Philadelphia is the one that you want to pattern after, because no matter what, they stood for Christ. You know, they stood the temptations, they stood the trials, and believe me, in the difference in the two is that the enemy gains power. He gains not power. Erase that word. He gains strength because he's got more and more people buffaloed, and they're following after him. They don't even realize, like we were talking about in this last time in Philadelphia, they don't even realize that when they're mimicking Christianity, they don't think they are. They think they truly are Christian, and that they're really following him, Satan.
Mm-hmm.
And because anything that is not of God, that does not talk about the Lord, does not believe in the Lord, does not actively stand for that, is Antichrist. And we know that that's from the devil. So the bottom line is that if you're going to I know I'm off on a track in my head, going back to what you said.
We were talking about Smyrna.
So Philadelphia is withstanding, that's my point, is where I was going. They are withstanding the brunt force. It would be like almost hurricane force of the enemy surrounding them, you know, and pushing on them. But they are standing like the foundation of a building that cannot be shaken, mm-hmm. like the foundation of the temple. So what was the question?
Smyrna and Revelation, they're both going through persecution, or is Christ keeping the Philadelphia church from
oh, no.
tribulation?
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, no. They are tribulated against. I mean, they have, mm-hmm. that isn't even a word, but you know what I mean? They are withstanding this massive force, but of all the churches, all of them, they are the mm-hmm. ones that we want to emulate in our stand for Christ, because they are stalwart. They will not move. They are unbudgeable. They never waver. They stand. And so that's what this means. And because they are, and they are for Christ, and they are unshakable, that's where he says, you'll have your white robes. You'll have your salvation. You're mine. You know, because you
it's
are.
It's like he told the Jews before they crossed the Red Sea. He said, stand and see the salvation of the Lord.
That's right.
And you shall hold your peace. And you shall hold your peace.
Mm-hmm.
So God is going to get the glory through them.
The whole thing is all about God's glory.
Yeah.
When we stand as Christians in tribulation and trials and we reach and call on the name of the Lord, let's just put it that way. We call on the name of the Lord. We stand and we don't agree with the enemy about what's going on. We call on the name of the Lord. We stand on what God promises us in the Word of God. Then we are doing exactly what we're supposed to do, glorifying God. Because when we do that, we open the opportunity for Him to come and be glorified. He gets the glory. Remember that God made a vow from the very beginning, the onset, that He would not intervene on anything that we're doing here. This is our kingdom. He placed us in it to rule and reign. And we've done a pretty poor job of it, you know. But regardless.
Yeah, I mean, the churches are supposed to be the world influence. That's
right.
How it started out.
That's right.
And it's not that way anymore.
And so He has created all of us to be priests. That's what his goal was. We were His priests. And yet there's only those of us now who are considered His priests because we are called royal priesthood. We have to give our life to Jesus Christ in order to attain that. Then we become royal priesthood. We are the priests of God. And it's our job to carry the church, which is the body of Christ, into glory, so that it can be, Jesus can have His body. You know, He's the head now, mm-hmm. up at in the heavenlies and the throne. But we are His body, and His body has to join His head. And then when we're raptured, that's when that happens. And he collects others, but we are special. There is no other like us, because we have to believe in something we cannot see with our physical eyes. The people that were His apostles and the patriarchs, oh my goodness, I'm not down speaking on them at all. But they saw Him. They were with Him and they saw Him. And they could believe because they saw. All right?
Mm-hmm.
We have to believe because we don't see. All right. Now, there are other raptures after ours. And we will go through them here in the book of Revelation. They're not as big. They're not as bold, and they don't hold the place that we hold. We are the light of the world. We're the salt of the earth. We're the apple of God's eye. And that's a special place. And it's only for people who are born again. So get born again right now. Are you fine?
Anybody who listens to us, they're going to be born again.
Yes.
They have no other choice.
Are you finding yourself wanting to be completely dependent on God? Well, you should be. If you desire to come into and dwell in the miraculous presence of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, if you desire to put on the armor of God and be in Christ, if you wish to avail yourself of His marvelous wisdom and power, you must give your life to Him. Oh, you must, you must, you must. You know, it's simple. It's pain-free. We make it hard in our own thinking, but it's so simple and it's pain-free. And in just a moment, we're going to give you that opportunity.
Longing for some way Love came for me. Love rescued me. Love called my name. Love took my place. Sweet Lamb of God, I'm bowing down. My eyes have seen. I'm finally free. Love came.
Family, if you want, I'm hearing my voice back again. I'll try to.
I can't turn it down anymore, I don't think.
Okay.
I'll try it. Let me see.
If you want to receive that open door today to Christ and have heaven touch earth, please repeat this after me today. We give you an opportunity every broadcast to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And we begin this, our Christian walk, with a very simple prayer that you will repeat after me. Now, God has given us the gift of repentance that we can use against all our sin, past, present, and future sin. So today he's going to instantly pardon your infinite debt. So just repeat this after me. Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of the living God. You were born, you came in the flesh to atone for my sins and all my sickness and disease on the cross. And then you were raised from the dead after 3 days. I come to you today, Lord, to repent of my sins against you now, and I ask you to forgive me. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I want to make you my Lord and Savior now and forever. I thank you for your grace, your love, your mercy, and your compassion for me. I believe that once I was lost, but today I am found. And I choose to serve you all the days of my life. Family, if you prayed that prayer, we welcome you into the family of God. We would love to disciple you in your walk with the Lord from this day forward. So we'll give you our contact information at the end of this program. And just welcome to the family of God.
Praise Father, Son.
Praise Father, Son.
Praise Father, Son.
You know, one of the most wonderful things and interesting things that we offer on this program is Old Testament history on Holy Communion and how it ties to our New Testament communion. Pastor Karen has actually a very special anointing for that, so I'm going to ask her right now to share it with us.
Yes, you know, family, about 3,500 years ago, the Hebrews people were slaves to the Egyptians. And as you know, the king of Egypt, Pharaoh, He was unwilling to release the Hebrews and allow them to return to Israel. So God sent 10 plagues upon the Egyptians. The 10th plague resulted in the death angel moving from house to house, taking the lives of the firstborn of the Egyptians, both men and beasts. But God had a different plan for the Hebrews. He told them to sacrifice a lamb and put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost of their houses. In Exodus 12:13, God said, "When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you." So thus the Hebrew families were protected from both sickness and death as a result of the blood and body of the Lamb. So we see that the appointed festival of Passover became the forerunner of the Lord's Supper, where the Lord Jesus himself becomes the sacrificial lamb, and his blood was shed on the cross for not only our sins, for our complete protection, our complete healing, our complete salvation, and our complete deliverance. And in fact, we understand that Jesus was having Passover with his disciples when he instituted the Last Supper with the New Covenant. The New Covenant said no longer would they emphasize deliverance from Egypt, but instead, each time they took the cup of wine and the unleavened bread, they would celebrate deliverance from sin and the promise of eternal life. You see, the blood of the Lamb in Egypt was a foreshadowing of the blood of Jesus, who was identified as the Lamb of God by John the Baptist in John 1:29. John said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." So the historical application of Passover is that we see its prophetic fulfillment in Christ, who as God's final perfect Lamb died during Passover. Now, communion also denotes the sharing of the elements and reminds us not only of our redemption through Christ, but but also our future inheritance with Christ in the kingdom of God. Matthew 26:29 says, But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of the fruit of this vine until the day that I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Now concerning the elements, the unleavened bread and wine or the Jewish unleavened bread used during Passover was called the bread of affliction because of the Hebrew slavery in Egypt. However, with the new covenant in Jesus, it is called the bread of life. Jesus said in John 6:32-33, I tell you for certain, Moses, that you were not the one who gave us the bread from heaven. And the bread that God gives us is the one who came down from heaven to give life to the world. I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger. He that believes in me shall never thirst. I am the living bread which came down from heaven, and if any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day, and whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. Your forefathers ate manna and died, but he who feeds on this bread will live forever. So family, we're not only proclaiming the Lord's death through these elements, but every time that we receive communion, every week that we receive communion here on Living the Word, we are receiving an impartation of life through this communion service today. Amen.
Amen. Do you know that you can receive healing simply by taking Holy Communion? It's actually one of the marvelous things that we receive from taking it, healing of our minds and our bodies. However, we have to prepare before taking Holy Communion, and part of that is what we have Pastor Karen bring to you just now from the Old Testament understanding. And we know that the Old Testament symbols of bread and wine still remain today, just as she has explained to you. And Jesus and his disciples used that same bread and wine at the Last Supper. And after all, it's because they were used to using it for the Passover. Now, because those items were used to draw the picture Jesus wanted them to see, we use those elements still today. However, it doesn't matter what food items you use. Use what you have available to you because it's acceptable, because we pray over the items, sanctifying them as the body and the blood of Christ. What's important is that you believe that those elements of the covenant become the body and the blood of Christ. Now, the Word of God tells us that the first thing we must do is discern the body of Christ. We do that by acknowledging that the bread or whatever food item you're using as the body of Christ is the vibrancy of the life of Jesus, his supernatural healing and wholeness, and that because of his body and his blood, you supernaturally have become bone of Jesus' bone and flesh of Jesus' flesh. That you're now filled with his perfection and power, completely healed, completely made whole, and completely restored to his divine health. You could think of it as medicine if you want, a pill that's glowing with the Shekinah glory of God. And that medicine, when you take medicine like an aspirin or something, you take it and you expect the headache to go away because that's what it's designed for. Same thing here. Imagine it as a pill. It's healing you as it travels through your mouth and down into your body. And as it goes, it's pushing out all sickness, all disease, and it's pushing it out from the inside out. Visualize the condition that you're plagued with, that sickness or disease being on Jesus' body. Put whatever your ailments are on him. Use your imagination. You're not giving him something he doesn't want. Remember, he already took it at the cross. Now, the enemy's trying to trick you into taking it by deceiving you into thinking you've got it through lying symptoms. But since Jesus took it at the cross, you're already healed and made whole. Put that lying symptom back on Jesus right in the same place on him you've been afflicted. See yourself without the problem. See yourself with a solution. That's spiritual visualization, folks. It's vital you understand it and do it. Now, if you've been diagnosed with a problem and are being treated by a doctor, then continue your treatment and medications, but add to it your faith and your taking of Holy Communion for healing and restoration. We believe in doctors. Don't just try to believe away your situations. See a doctor and get a name for what's plaguing you, because everything with a name has to bow to the name of Jesus. The next thing we do in preparation is discern the blood of Christ. We discern it as the forgiveness of all sin, past, present, and future, as restoration of the blessing to your life, that power and authority of God in your life in full operation, as receiving God's provision and protection, receiving the gift of righteousness from Jesus Christ, thanking God for his plan of redemption, and that you've even been included in it, that you've been given eternal life, life everlasting, and now you no longer live under the law, but you live under his grace. Now lift up the elements of the covenant. These are the items I asked you to assemble at the beginning of the program. Lift them up before the Lord as I pray. Give me just a second here because I got to get ready. Always prepared. That's me. Okay. Let's pray. Father, we praise you and worship you with these elements of the covenant. We thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus, gave his life sacrificially so that we may live and have life more abundantly. We thank you now as this food item becomes our portion of his healing body and the vibrancy of his life within us. We thank you that as we partake of the body of Christ, we become healed and made whole, completely restored. We thank you that this beverage becomes our portion of his cleansing blood, that we are continually washed in the waterfall of his precious blood and renewed within as we continually remember his act of love on the cross on our behalf. In the name of all name, above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, we know that the Lord's Supper is a personal fellowship. It's a partnership with Christ, and partaking of one bread actually creates that partnership between the members, the disciples as well. It merges them all together into one body, and it's known as the church. The Word of God commands us to eat the bread and drink the cup. Continually, we take that bread, give thanks, break it and eat it, then take the cup, give thanks and drink it, all in the remembrance of Jesus. You know, the Lord commanded that the supper be repeated often, and yet Paul doesn't really give us any instruction as to the frequency that we're supposed to celebrate the Lord's Supper with. He leaves it really open-ended, and he does imply, though, that it should be done with frequency, so that partaking of the Lord's Supper recalls to our mind continually our redemption by Christ from all sickness and all disease and all sin. So do it as often as you want to, my friends, and as often as you need to. Now, as we're instructed, we discern the body and the blood of Christ as we prepare to partake. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you that this item of food has become the bread of life and has become the healing body of our Lord Jesus the Christ. The body of our Lord Jesus, broken for you so that every cell, every tissue, every organ and bone, all systems, neurological, blood vascular, lymphatic, muscular, skeletal, all systems, are totally aligned with God's word and his will, that you are and remain healed, made whole, and totally restored to divine health and wholeness. In the name of Jesus, our healer, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the body of our Lord and Savior. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father, we thank you that this beverage has become the precious saving blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. The blood of our Lord Jesus shed for you in celebration of the finished work of Jesus on the cross for the remission of all of your sins, past, present, and future. For the restoration of the empowerment of God, the blessing in your life, and the gift of righteousness. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer and Savior, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the blood of our Lord and Savior. Pastor Karen, will you give us a closing blessing?
Yes, family. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace always. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Did you receive this today? We pray that you did. I know that we've gone on and on and on, but we could go on all day and all night. This is a nonstop with us. We have to force ourselves to quit. But if you need further assistance with understanding any of our message, please contact us. Pastor Karen, do you have anything you want to share with the folks?
No, just tune into the Bible study tonight, which is at 6 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. Fort Collins is starting a volunteer type of work where they'll come in and do light cooking and visit with people who are ill or ill in some form or mm-hmm. manner. And I'm trying to get them to expand it in this town so that we can come in with healing also and use the gifts, use the power gifts. So just pray for me, family, that that will take place and just be healed in Jesus' name.
Amen. You know, I was watching the Daytona 500 yesterday for a minute, and and I saw a commercial where this Jeff Gordon, one of the drivers that's now retired from driving, but he is doing something with AARP to stop hunger in the elderly. There's so many old people out there that don't have any money or food. You know, maybe they have just enough because they barely make it on their Social Security and they don't have enough food. And he is fighting hunger that way, and they're taking I don't know if they're taking donations. I don't know how it works, but you can go online to AARP.com and find out what's going on with that if you're interested, any of you, and you might find out an avenue for you, Karen.
Okay.
You can contact me at masterstouchhs@gmail.com. That's masterstouchhs@gmail.com. Thank you all for joining us for Living the Word. Remember, Bible study, as Karen was telling you, Bible study, you can log in at skype.com. masterstouchhs is the login. At 6 p.m. tonight, we also are archived on many different places. We look forward to hearing from you and seeing you, and send us comments. Come and listen. You know, or you can go into the archives. Remember, Proverbs 4:7 tells us that wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom, and in all of your getting, get understanding. And that's exactly what we're doing here, seeking and gaining God's wisdom from His Word. Living the Word's a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. We're a 501c3 organization. And we leave you with this reminder. You know, we're always going to do it. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17 tells us that as Jesus is, so are we in this world. So right now, however Jesus is, perfect, prosperous, abundant, full of divine health and wholeness, you know, that's exactly how you are too. Meditate on that scripture until you become it, my friends. God bless you.